Seminar announcements or other announcements? Okay, I'm going to turn it over to Bree Rosenblum to introduce today's speaker.
Well, it's my pleasure to introduce Dr. Chris Martin. Chris is currently a Miller postdoc fellow here at UC Berkeley. He's housed in my lab and also in Craig Miller's lab in MCB. And Chris had his BS from Duke, his PhD from UC Davis in 2013, and is going to be moving on to a faculty position in the biology department at UNC Chapel Hill this next year. And I just wanted to put a couple of seeds in the brain of graduate students. If you're thinking about benchmarks to reach by the end of your PhD, I know Chris won't like this, but there's two notable things in numbers of 10 that Chris did professionally by the time he finished his PhD. The first is that he had done field work in at least 10 countries, if you counted them up from your CV. And the second is that he had published 10 papers, including one first authored in Science. So those are a couple of good 10s to shoot for.
10 papers in Science.
A couple good 10s to shoot for. And then I know in the tradition that started last semester of fun facts about the seminar speaker, in addition to being completely obsessed with fish, Chris is also completely obsessed with pug dogs. And he once told our lab that his long-term goal was to have one pug for every family member. So keep your eye on Chris. He is absolutely a rising star in evolutionary biology, and someday we'll may have a lot of dogs.
Well, thank you so much, Bree, for that generous introduction. And thank you all for coming. So I'm interested in the process of adaptive radiation. And as many of you who know me quickly learn, I'm also a complete fish nut. So this is really fortunate because there's many, many fish systems that are excellent for studying adaptive radiation. And indeed, the extremes of the diversification process are represented within teleost fishes. So on one extreme, the most spectacular vertebrate adaptive radiation on Earth, in my opinion, 1,500 species of Malawi cichlids evolving within 2 million years, filling a diverse range of ecological niches, morphological diversity. So this is the epitome of an adaptive radiation, a burst of morphological, ecological, and species diversification. So then take the other extreme. These two butterfly fish species in West Africa, one in the Niger River, one in the Congo River, have been isolated for 50 million years. But even taxonomists thought they were the exact same species until just a few years ago when some of their DNA was finally sequenced. So this is one of the most fantastic examples of morphological stasis. And even within an environment like Lake Malawi, where we know exceptional adaptive radiation can occur in cichlids, there's three other lineages of cichlids that have failed to diversify in this very same lake. And then in the Congo River, this African butterfly fish fails to diversify. But this lineage of marmirids, elephant nose fishes, has rapidly diversified. And coming full circle, there's three different lineages of marmirids that have failed to diversify in Lake Malawi. So what all this means is that it's not just the environment, and it's not just the lineage that drives adaptive radiation. And I'm very interested in developing new systems for understanding this process to address why some lineages succeed and other lineages fail. And I realized over the years, a lot of my approach to this process can be described by Crow's principle. So this is an idea that many of you are familiar with, that for every biological question, there's the perfect organism or perfect system out there for answering that question, which was apparently inspired by a certain kind of tortoise with the uniquely branching trachea that was expressly created for the purposes of respiration physiology. But this principle, I think, cuts both ways, that for every system out there, it's asking an outstanding question. So for my talk today, I'll focus on my two systems. My main system is a localized adaptive radiations of Caribbean pupfishes. And the outstanding question, why is adaptive radiation so rare in this group? And a possible answer from my empirical measurements of the fitness landscape, raising F2 hybrids, taking them back to the field, and measuring their growth and survival. And then, very quickly, I'll talk about my second system, the Cameroon Crater Lake cichlids, which present the outstanding question, what are the conditions for one of the most compelling examples of St. Patrick speciation in the wild? What conditions allow this process to proceed? And finally, I'll talk about a quick twist on Crow's principle that I'm still processing this, but I just have to share it with you, this story that's happened to me in the last few months. So if you're familiar with pupfishes, has anybody here seen the devil's hole pupfish? Or, okay, so not that many of you, but if you're familiar with them, you know that they're often restricted to desert springs like Death Valley, California. Here's the Devil's Hole pupfish. This is the smallest habitat of any vertebrate in the wild that I know of. And I'm extremely fortunate to be collaborating with Jacob Crawford on a project estimating the age of this species. They're quite young. But pupfishes also occur all across the Atlantic and Caribbean, from Massachusetts down to Venezuela, throughout the Atlantic. And throughout this range, as well as throughout desert pupfish populations, these are almost all allopatric generalist species. So here's just a collection of generalists. They all feed essentially on algae, detritus, except in two places. And one of those is this tiny island of San Salvador, 11 miles long. It contains not just a generalist, but two specialist pupfish species. And these salt lakes in the center of the island where these species occur are only 10,000 years old. There's the second radiation in Simpatri in Laguna Chichinquenab. So this is in the center of the Yucatan. Again, one generalist and multiple specialist species coexisting. Now, I know what you're thinking when I say rapid fish radiation, but these are not, pufffish do this too, just like stickleback, but these are not your typical examples of ecological speciation, where a large and a small species use a subset of the ancestral resource base. Instead, these radiations contain novel ecological specialists. So a scale eater with these huge oral jaws, a molluscivore with this unique protruding nasal appendage, as well as this generalist. And to give you a sense of these trophic morphologies, I'll pass around 3D prints of these three skulls as I talk. So these three are all scaled to the same size fish, but this will give you an idea of just how dramatic these phenotypic changes are. And all of these morphologies are heritable when reared in a laboratory environment. So these are just F1 generation plotted on a discriminant morphospace. And just notice that these are three distinct clusters of phenotypes. So I first discovered that San Salvador Island contains the only scale-eating pupfish known. And here it is in the wild, biting scales off an unsuspecting generalist. So here's the scale eater. They do this all day long, about once every minute. 50% of their diet is the scales of other pupfish. And they're not just eating the scales, but the protein-rich mucus coat that surrounds the fish. So this is probably a more nutritious diet than the typical diet of algae in the generalist. Now, let's see that in slow motion in the laboratory. So here's a euthanized generalist pupfish. Here's a female scale-eating pupfish. So you should all be humming the Jaws theme right now. Look at that jaw extension. So, and see the shoot of scales coming off of that fish. So this female actually ate the scales off the bottom of the tank afterwards. And this species didn't have a name yet, so I named it the squamator, which is Latin for one who removes scales from another fish. So there's other scale-eating fishes out there, such as these. But the most closely related scale eater is actually an African cichlid. And just to put it that in context, these two species are separated by 168 million years of evolution. There's over 6,000 species in between that have not colonized this niche. So this, to me, is ecological novelty. Now there's a second specialist, molluscivore. And this guy actually has a unique protruding nasal appendage that sticks out above the upper jaw right here. And it's not just tissue, it's actually a skeletal extension on this maxilla, this bone in blue. I've got an even bigger 3D print here. So you guys can get a load of this. But here's this unique novel nasal protrusion on the skeleton. So this nasal protrusion really reminded me of this nasal protrusion. I think we have at least some paleontologists out here. Anybody know what this guy is? So this is a brontothere. It's an extinct mammal from the Pleistocene. So I named this species Brontothroides in honor of this extinct mammal. And here it is feeding on a snail. Sorry?
Brontotheres don't eat mollusks.
Well, just wait. So here he is feeding on a snail in the lab, and he actually grasps the snail in his oral jaws, retracts that, and wedges the snail shell against that protrusion. So I think this actually forms sort of an additional appendage as a stabilizing lever to help him break apart that snail shell as he shakes his head from side to side. Now, there's actually another fish out there that has a similar nasal appendage. And this one actually eats mussels. It's called the black mussel cracker from the coast of South Africa. And over 8 years of studying this fish, no one knew about this thing until I finally learned about this guy on Facebook. So, go figure. But what I've shown you so far is that novel ecological specialists have only evolved on the island of San Salvador. And again, I want to emphasize, unlike stickleback, these are not habitat specialists that live in the benthic or limnetic zone. These occur in full sympatry. So here I just want to show you a slice of pupfish heaven. There's generalists all over the place. There's the durophage female down here, and then at the very end is a scale-eater male right there. So all these species live and breed in these shallow, macroalgae-dominated saline lakes across seven different lakes on San Salvador where multiple species co-occur. So I did a RADseq project, genotyping over 13,000 SNPs, and I just want to show you that in a maximum likelihood phylogeny, scale-eater species from multiple lakes all cluster together. So there's limited, there is reproductive isolation in these species. And then across lakes, basically within lake, these molluscivores also cluster together. Now it might look like there's three independent evolution of molluscivores, but ABBA tests for introgression indicate that there's also gene flow among these three. And we see the same pattern in a principal component analysis of about 25% of the variation in these SNPs. Again, scale eaters are clustering together in this side of the space, and within lakes, these species are clustering together. Similarly, in a structure analysis, more isolation of the scale eater, but these species are generally social structure. So overall, I just want to emphasize that these species are reproductively isolated in sympatry, despite some low levels of gene flow. Now finally, what about the hallmark of adaptive radiation? Do these radiation, does it exhibit a burst of morphological diversification? So to look for this, one of the first chapters of my dissertation was to construct a mitochondrial phylogeny from across Cyprinodon, shown here. Then I measured 16 functional traits from cleared and stained pupfish specimens. And then finally compared 1 and 2 rate models of Brownian motion. So this was a way to look at the rate of morphological diversification on San Salvador relative to the background rate in allopatric species across the Caribbean. And so I'm showing this as a heat map. So for each trait that I measured, this heat color indicates how fast the San Salvador radiation is diversifying. And note that this is a log scale. So jaw length is actually diversifying 51 times faster than background rates in any other pupfish population, which is remarkably fast. So I've shown you so far, San Salvador pupfishes show the hallmarks of adaptive radiation: ecological novelty, reproductively isolated in sympatry, and rapid rates of morphological diversification. But I mentioned there's a second radiation. So in Laguna Chichincanab, again, it's only 8,000 years old, dated pretty accurately by cores from this lake. But again, we see a trophic specialist, but a different set. So here's a piscivore, one of the largest pupfishes, and a zooplanktivore here. And just look at this remarkable difference in the robustness of their oral jaws and the thickness of their tooth length. And again, we see even faster rates of morphological diversification within this radiation. So tooth length is diversifying 130 times faster than background rates. Now, so overall, evolution of novel trophic specialists is clearly linked to exceptional rates of morphological diversification in Caribbean pupfishes. But this begs the outstanding question, I think, for this system, is why are adaptive radiations so rare in pupfishes? Right, all this range, here's the only two places where we see sympatric radiations. And of course, the first thing we need to do is to compare these two habitats. So here's salt lakes on San Salvador. These are salty, shallow lakes. The similar lake is Laguna Chichincanab. It's slightly saline, dominated by macroalgae, carbonate geology. And even more so, there's only one major competing fish species in each of these environments. In both cases, it's a mosquito fish, a gambusia, because these lakes are so saline that no other fish species can tolerate this environment. So right now, I should just stop this talk. I should just walk away, because we have the answer right here, right? What's causing adaptive radiation? Ecological opportunity. So this is widely reported in the literature, right? We have a new environment like Hawaii, like Lake Malawi, like the Galapagos Islands. There's few competitors, there's abundance of resources. And we know from the literature that this is what causes adaptive radiation, ecological opportunity. It's all about the ecology. But for all of these other systems, they're unique environments, right? There's no other Galapagos Islands that we could compare this to. And in this system, I think it's excellent for answering this outstanding question, because there are thousands of other environments just like it across the Caribbean. So in yellow here are museum collections of pupfishes. In blue are collections where I've personally looked for pupfishes. And just for example, zooming in on the area in the Bahamas around San Salvador, there are hypersaline salt lakes on these islands surrounding San Salvador. All of these contain generalist pupfishes and only mosquito fish. But none of them contain specialist pupfishes. So what's going on? So on the left here are three lakes on San Salvador that support multiple specialist pupfish species. And on the right are three similar lakes from neighboring islands that support only generalists. So these are ringed in mangroves, carbonate geology, only one or two other competing fish species, mosquito fish and silver sides. So it looks like similar amounts of ecological opportunity here. So what about lake area? So here I'm plotting just lake area relative to the number of pupfish species, just to emphasize that these turquoise lakes from neighboring islands are the same size as the lakes on San Salvador. And also note that the smallest lake on San Salvador supports two pupfish species. So it doesn't appear to be lake area. I really thought for 6 years, I thought it was going to be genetic diversity. I thought San Salvador has a lot of lakes. It should have more genetic diversity, which would spur adaptive radiation. Then with the RADSeq data, I looked at genetic diversity on San Salvador relative to these other islands. It's not elevated. And this guy here is one of the largest islands, so that's probably why. But essentially, I think what's happening is gene flow is so frequent that it's homogenizing genetic diversity across all these lake populations. And even lakes, individual lakes, have similar genetic diversity to island-wide levels. So it's not genetic diversity. And at this point, I'm just sort of throwing up my hands because I still don't know what it is. I also thought, well, morphological diversity on San Salvador, they should be more diverse, right, if there's more ecological opportunity. So I measured a whole bunch of functional traits, again, on cleared and stained specimens. And here I'm showing you the first two principal component axes of morphological variation for San Salvador. So here's all the generalist populations I measured on San Salvador, molluscivore populations, and scale eater populations. And then here's all the neighboring generalist populations, which largely overlap in this morphospace. Not what we'd expect would be a much narrower range or more variance on San Salvador. And we see a similar pattern for dietary isotopic diversity. So I also looked at nitrogen and carbon isotopes, which indicate relative trophic position and dietary source of carbon. Again, here's generalist populations across San Salvador. Here's generalist populations across neighboring islands. Again, I think these are largely overlapping in dietary space as well as dietary diversity. So again, why are adaptive radiations so rare if there's thousands of similar saline lakes with equal levels of ecological opportunity? And my approach to answering this question now is really to think about the fitness landscape. So this is the complex relationship between phenotype and fitness, which we visualize as a rugged landscape and expect species in the wild to correspond to these fitness peaks. But this is also the foundation of the ecological theory of adaptive radiation. So multiple fitness peaks we expect to drive adaptive radiation. As a lineage colonizes a new environment, these different peaks corresponding to different novel resources would drive divergent selection. But at the same time, local fitness peaks can also constrain adaptive radiation. So the classic problem on any fitness landscape is that a population can only explore locally. So it climbs up this fitness peak and then becomes stuck because there's stabilizing selection on that population that would limit phenotypic diversification, even though there might be a higher fitness peak nearby. So what we really need to do is we need a time machine to go back in time to when pupfish first colonized San Salvador Island and measure what that fitness landscape looks like. So I tried to do this when I was 6 years old. I actually built a time machine. Here's my time machine. I'm going to continue Bree's tradition of showing a childhood picture of myself. And unfortunately, the time machine didn't work. But in grad school, you can do the next best thing. So we can simulate ancestral diversity by generating two large hybrid populations. So I collected breeding colonies of all three species from two different lakes in San Salvador, brought these back to my fish room at Davis, bred F1 hybrids in all directions from these three species, and then finally outbred F2 hybrids from intercrosses and backcrosses, generating over 2,000 F2 hybrids, showing a range of phenotypic variation, sometimes exceeding the range seen in the wild, and also sort of filling up those gaps between the phenotypic clusters seen in the wild. So ranges in body depth, in lower jaw length, and the beginnings of that duraphase of that molluscivore nasal protrusion, and eye diameter. So then I injected each hybrid with this 1 millimeter tag that has a 5-digit unique code on it, photographed them in the lab. Here's an injected fish being photographed, bagged them up in breathable, oxygen permeable fish bags, packed them into my checked baggage here, and took them back to San Salvador Island, the holding tanks shown here, while I built field enclosures in their natural habitat. So learned to pour concrete for the first time, built these field enclosures, and finally reintroduced these F2 hybrids to the same lakes from which their grandparents were originally collected 3 years earlier. So I built a low density and high density enclosure in two different lakes with about 100 and 800 hybrids in each of these two lakes. So entirely replicated between the two lakes. Set these up in March, and then came back in July, and they are still there. And I know this doesn't look like much, but this is probably the most beautiful thing I've ever seen. It's right here. And the environments inside these enclosures look really similar to outside. So this is essentially just a carpet of macroalgae. Then was able to recapture these hybrids because I built the enclosures as a sealed mesh bag, so I could just lift up the bottom of the enclosure and collect all the survivors, then read their tags. And there was much higher survival of tagged fish in low-density enclosures in both lakes, which is good, because that means much stronger competition at high density, like we expect. Then from these pre-release photographs of all the hybrids, I could take 16 measurements of the phenotype, as well as taking measurements of these parental purebred fish raised in the same laboratory environment. So here for reference is a discriminant morphospace. So this is just maximizing phenotypic separation among these three parental species. And here I'm just showing you 95% density ellipses for each of these species. But this is just a morphospace that indicates phenotypic similarity to each of these three parental species. Then within that space, I can plot all the F2 hybrids that died in field enclosures in gray. And here are all the F2 hybrids that survived in black. So this is the raw survival data for the first high-density enclosure in Lake 1. And then to this raw survival data, I fit thin plate splines, which is just a non-parametric way of visualizing the curvature of this surface. So this is the fitness landscape here, this heat map. And look at how complex this surface is. So it ranges from 25% survival here, down to maybe 10%, all the way down to less than 5% around these edges. So this is one of the most comprehensive snapshots of natural selection in the wild, because it's actually a manipulation of multiple species phenotypes. And just for reference, here's the parental range of the molluscivore, the parental range of the generalist, and the parental range of the scale eater way out here. So the surface is too complex to analyze with parametric methods, but I can cut slices through the surface like this, then visualize selection along this slice with smoothing splines, and then pick out quadratic intervals directly for actual statistical tests of selection. So there's significant disruptive selection against these intermediates here. And just for reference, here's the phenotypes of the parents. again, significant stabilizing selection on generalists. And I can cut a slice in the other direction, and again, we see significant stabilizing selection on hybrids that resemble this generalist phenotype. So in this first lake, I then have the independent fitness data of growth rate. So just these surviving hybrids, I could look at their growth rate and similarly plot a thin plate spline. And I'm really encouraged to see that, again, there's two fitness peaks here in roughly the same region of this morphospace. And in the second lake, I was missing one of the back crosses. So I've basically covered about half of morphospace in the second lake. But again, similar trends of higher fitness on this edge of the fitness landscape. Now, just to summarize what's most striking about this, is here's, again, that high-density first lake fitness landscape in two dimensions and three dimensions. I just note that the phenotypes of hybrids resembling the generalist here sit on an isolated fitness peak. So fitness is decreasing in all directions away from this peak. Then next to that peak, there's a significant fitness valley and a taller fitness peak corresponding to the phenotype of the molluscivore specialist here. And that higher peak is actually significantly taller using a permutation test. And again, this peak is taller with the independent data set of growth rate. And finally, there's this third species, right? That's the awesome scale eater, which did poorly in all treatments in both lakes, that hybrids over here resembling the scale eater almost never survived. And I was quite surprised by this. I actually thought the opposite would happen because these scale eater hybrids are the most aggressive. I thought they might dominate resources in these enclosures and I'd have nothing but a bunch of fat and happy scale eaters at the very end. The opposite of that seems to happen. And I think the reason is that, if you'll notice, only four of these F2 hybrids are even within this 95% ellipse for the scale eater parent. And none of these were quite as extreme as a purebred scale eater. So I think that this foraging niche of scale eating might require a very extreme phenotype. And if you don't have all of the traits necessary for that high performance extreme phenotype, you don't survive. So in other words, I think that there is a fitness peak for scale eating, a third fitness peak. It might be actually out here, and that I wasn't able to detect that peak with the range of variation within my hybrids. So to sum up, we can think about how these two specialist niches actually shape the topography of the fitness landscape. So here, molluscivore is a pretty similar niche to being a generalist. All you have to do is go up and crush snails, maybe just increase the mechanical advantage of a simple lever ratio, your jaws, right? And I think this translates into a closer fitness peak on the adaptive landscape, one that's easier to colonize. So we might see molluscivores evolving more often across cyprinodonta forms, and indeed that's what we see. But in contrast, scale eating is a high performance niche. It requires high speed strikes on evasive prey with a very low payoff per strike. So you have to be extremely efficient to succeed at this niche. And indeed, all scale eaters are limited in not growing larger than the size of their prey, or else the cost-benefit ratio doesn't work anymore. And I think this translates into actually a distant fitness peak on the adaptive landscape. So I don't have any evidence for this peak, but I do have evidence for a wider fitness valley that separates these scale eater hybrids from generalists than this fitness valley separating molluscivore and generalists. And it's also interesting to point out that this fitness landscape explains the patterns I showed you initially. So a higher fitness peak could drive more rapid rates of trait diversification and stronger selection against scale eating hybrids in this region than against molluscivore hybrids in this region would predict more reproductive isolation between scale eaters in these two species because of stronger postzygotic extrinsic isolation. And indeed, that's what we see. And indeed, this even predicts that scale-eating females should be more discriminating in their choice of mates than molluscivore females. And I've started some kiddie pool experiments where I measured mate choice in these kiddie pools in the lab. So this is just showing association time where a female spent more time with conspecific males than heterospecific males. And indeed, that's what we see. The scale-eater females have a significant preference for scale-eater males. The molluscophore females have no preference in this laboratory setup. But back to this outstanding question, why are adaptive radiations so rare? So perhaps these generalist populations across the Caribbean are not only stranded on an isolated fitness peak on San Salvador, but also on an isolated fitness peak across all of these other saline lake populations. So if that's true, there would be widespread stabilizing selection on generalists across all of these populations, which would limit their phenotypic diversification. Except in a few places like San Salvador, Chichinquinab, where they can escape this local fitness maximum. So of course, this leads to the next question. How have populations managed to escape these local fitness peaks? And I think answering this is going to be a combination of asking, what about the underlying genetics of these unique trophic adaptations? Right? Is it de novo variation on San Salvador? Is it standing genetic variation from elsewhere? And how do interactions among these loci, how do they shape that fitness landscape? Alternatively, it might just be really subtle differences in the selective regime across these different islands that I haven't picked up. So the first thing which I'm working on permits to do is to measure fitness landscapes on neighboring islands to directly compare what these look like. But I've also started more experiments on San Salvador. So this experiment is for basically my major postdoc experiment that I set up this past May. So this time almost 4,000 F5 hybrids, despite the fact that Delta lost one of my coolers, which had 1,200 live pupfish inside, which was never recovered. So, in spite of that, I got these guys out there, and this time, in addition to photographing and tagging them, I also fin clipped them. So I have genotypes of all these fish, and we'll know genotypes, you know, survival, right, in these enclosures. So I've actually collected these two, and after 3 months, same as the first experiment, but it failed in a really surprising way, is that 800 out of about 850 hybrids survived. So even though the enclosures were only a little bit larger. So I left the other two out there, and they're still out there now, I hope. And I'll collect them after about 9 to 12 months in the field. And I've also generated the first pupfish linkage map. So this is just a pilot linkage map, but I have two crosses between those specialist species of over 300 F2 hybrids to start to map the genetic architecture of these traits. So, shifting gears, I just want to talk about my second study system quickly. So, Cameroon crater lake cichlids, just like pupfishes, are replicated adaptive radiations in lakes, where in some lakes they've diversified, in other lakes they've failed to diversify. But there's an added twist here, and I think this quote sums it up. It is, even Coyne and Orr, noted skeptics of sympatric speciation, note that there's no more convincing example in nature. So sympatric speciation, the evolution of reproductive isolation without geographic barriers of any kind, easily one of the most controversial processes in evolutionary biology. So as I started grad school, I couldn't believe that nobody was currently studying this system. So here it is, there's four different sympatric radiations in three different crater lakes that I'm circling here. Up to 11 species, 9 species in these tiny little lakes. And basically, they're so isolated, so uniform, and so many species that the argument is that the alternative of allopatric speciation just doesn't seem possible. Because there's no way that these sort of allopatric isolating barriers could have formed in these uniform crater basins. So I went to Cameroon, got funding, went to Cameroon to start to study this system. And of course, fieldwork is just fantastically difficult in Cameroon. And a lot of you are familiar with this, but I mean, does anybody know what this is?
Gas station.
Yeah, exactly. So this is a gas station in the area around one of the lakes. I did public transport. It's 8 men to a car, and the driver sits on someone's lap to squeeze more people in. And then wherever you go, unlike many field sites, in West Africa, you have to ask permission from local chiefs. And it's really hit or miss. I mean, sometimes they're very happy, and sometimes they say they run you out and you can never come back. But luckily, I had the most fantastic field guide ever, Cyril Denning. So he's a local fish exporter and also a kindred fish nut. So So just like me. So Cyril and I traveled to two of the three lakes containing endemic sympatric radiations of cichlids. The Burambian bow is about 2 kilometers across, so it's 3 times smaller than the largest lake on San Salvador Island. But it contains 11 endemic cichlid species, including novel ecological specialists like this sponge-eating specialist. We also went to Lake Ijagam. That's only 900 meters across. But 2 different endemic radiations of cichlids, 3 of these species, and the second distantly related golden lineage of Ceratherodon cichlids. So first question I had was even, what's the evidence for sympatric speciation? Really needs to be revisited. And the first question is, were these craters colonized only once? So again, this is a RADSEQ project generating about 30,000 SNPs for these maximum likelihood phylogenies. And I have a bunch of outgroup samples from across Africa and Cameroon. And here's all 4 of the sympatric radiations. And I just want to point out here that if we look at bootstrap support for monophyly, so a single colonization of these 3 radiations, in only 1 of these radiations is bootstrap support 100%, supporting monophyly in all of the bootstrap samples. And if we look at principal component analysis of about 45% of the variation in this data set, so here I'm plotting 1 sympatric radiation from Burambian bow. Here's an outgroup in a different crater lake. And if this was a single colonization, what we should see is 2 independent axes here. So all of these species should be diverging perpendicular to this axis of divergence relative to this outgroup. But instead, we see a cluster of species that looks to be genetically more closely related to this outgroup than these other 2 species. So this pattern in principal component space is consistent with multiple colonizations of the crater. And indeed, with a formal test out of BABA statistic of was there introgression into these craters, some of these tests are significant, slightly significant, indicating introgression. And we see the same pattern for the second 2 lakes. So here in dark green, some of these individuals, all belonging to 1 species, are more closely related to these outgroups in orange. And for the second sympatric radiation of 9 species in light green, again, some of the individuals look to share more ancestry with these outgroups in orange and red. Again, introgression statistics are significant. So were the craters colonized only once? No. So there's some evidence for multiple colonization for all 4 of these sympatric crater radiations. And another question about whether sympatric speciation even occurred in these lakes is, are these even good species? Are they reproductively isolated species? So here's some structure data. So Bayesian clustering for 2 of the sympatric radiations here and here relative to some outgroups. So there's lots of structure in outgroups, so that's good. But then note, so this is the Berman radiation with 9 described species, with multiple individuals sequenced from each of these 9, almost completely homogeneous in their genetic ancestry. So really looks doubtful to me that there's many species within this lake. And we see the same pattern for Ijagam. There's 3 described species in this lake, but genetically homogeneous. And add to that the fact that I focused on large random samples from a focal species pair in Burambian bow, these 2 guys. We went out, Cyril and I, and just collected as many as we could. And then I focused on traits that seemed to differentiate these, like eye size, jaw length. All of the traits that I measured were unimodal. So unlike the pupfish, these are not discrete bimodal phenotypic clusters like I was expecting. These 2 representative photographs are the extremes of a continuum. And most of the individuals I captured were intermediate in morphology. We saw the same pattern in a second focal species pair from another lake, unimodal trait distributions. So 2 of the 3 radiations are genetically undifferentiated. And species complexes in all 3 radiations are unimodal in trait distribution. So there's really many of these species don't look like even good reproductively isolated species. Which presents this new outstanding question, right? Is there even sympatric speciation? And if it's happened at all, why is it incomplete? So this species complex if it wasn't the result of secondary colonization, then it looks to be either stalled or diverging extremely slowly. And what's really fascinating is that many of these St. Patrick speciation models, and there's lots and lots of these models because theorists are really interested in this process, but many of these actually predict stalled speciation without strong disruptive selection. So moderate levels of disruptive selection can start the process of St. Patrick divergence, but it doesn't finish the process. And they show that it can actually become stalled like that forever. So this brings us back to the fitness landscape. So to do this, it's impossible for me to take all these hybrids in the lab of Cameroon cichlids and back to the field. That's just really, really impossible. What I can do is use this proxy of growth rate, which is the scale growth rings and spacing. So similar to growth rings on a tree, fish have growth rings on their scales. And these explain about 50% of the variation in body growth rate in a laboratory trial I did with Cameroon cichlids. Just note, this is a low feeding trial and this is a high feeding trial in the lab. Here's a wild caught cichlid. So using this proxy for growth rate, I could then estimate fitness landscapes for a collection of relevant ecological traits like jaw length and head depth. And here I'm showing you the most curved surfaces. So note that these are curved upwards at the edges, which indicates disruptive selection. I did find significant disruptive selection on trophic morphology within these species complexes that were unimodal. But the strongest selection gradient, 0.16, is not as strong as is needed as predicted by the models. So it looks like only moderate disruptive selection in these species complexes, not enough to complete the process of St. Patrick speciation. So I'm in the very early stages of developing this system, but I'm really fascinated by this group because there's actually 30 more crater lakes, some of which have just a single endemic species. And my guess at this point is that for these species complexes around the edges that are stalled, those may be the only real examples of St. Patrick divergence. Whereas more ecologically distinct and phenotypically distinct species like this guy, the skinny sponge eater, might result from secondary colonization or parapatric speciation within the craters. Okay, so in the last 5 minutes, I just want to end with this depressing twist on Crow's principle. So it actually cuts both ways, that when a species goes extinct, or a system goes extinct, we lose the ability as scientists to address the outstanding question that that system poses. And for the last, 3 months, I've been on sort of a roller coaster ride with this species, Megupsalon aperus. So I think this is going to be the first documented vertebrate extinction of 2015, because the last individual on Earth is currently in my fish room in the basement of LSA. And the story starts, this species is endemic to a single desert spring in northeastern Mexico called El Potosí. And it's actually only the third place where multiple pupfish species coexist. And I should note, this is the only photograph of the original habitat. So, but these two are not actually sister species. So Megupsalon aperus is right here. It's the closest outgroup to all of Cyprinidon. And this goes back to my original question, because you have two lineages of the same age. Right? One, Cyprinidon, goes on to colonize the entire Caribbean and Atlantic. The other is now restricted to this single, essentially a cow pasture. So, and why? So what's the difference between these lineages where one is so successful and one fails to diversify? And there's actually quite a few unique traits about Megupsalon as well. It's got novel gill flaring, it's got a novel sex chromosome, and a chromosome fusion. So these outstanding questions, as well as the question of how do these two species coexist in sympatry, probably can't be answered now. And because of this, so Saprina's company in the mid-90s drained El Potosí for irrigation for potatoes, so just for potato chips. There was no local opposition, there was no international opposition, but five individuals were taken out of that spring, and they made it to captivity. And they made their way here. So this is the Dallas Children's Aquarium, where in the back room, I mean, this is a marine aquarium, but in the back room of this place, one guy, Charles Yancey, kept this colony of Megupsalon going for 20 years. And he gave out colonies to folks in Germany, in Spain, in the US, and in Mexico. And all of those different captive breeders, they all lost their colonies in the long term. And since I started grad school, I've been trying to get a hold of a colony to start breeding them. This past year, I hadn't heard anything for a while. Finally got a hold of this guy. And he tells me, well, 4 eggs hatched this year only. All turned out to be male. And they're already a year old, so near the end of their lifespan. And the aquarium told no one about this until I called. But they were happy to ship these two males to me for a hybrid cross. I was also like, oh, you know, we could have tried to sex reverse one of these males, as, you know, these fish are often even easy to sex reverse. So here is just the only videos now of this species are actually on my hard drive and backed up in the cloud. But here's Megupsalon. Here's the first female that he's ever seen in his entire life. And I am happy to report that I've had lots of F1 hybrids now and I'm working on a back cross. So at least I can possibly get at some of the genetic basis of these unique traits. But why am I telling you this story? I think this is what modern vertebrate extinction looks like, where most biodiversity are microendemic species. And most of biodiversity, these microendemics, are also quite small, that so much so that they can be kept in somebody's backyard, in their basement. So there's a guy in Colorado who kept 30 species of pupfishes, many of them extinct in the wild, kept them in his backyard for about 30 years. There's another guy in Lubbock, Texas, who keeps an extinct in the wild pupfish in his backyard. He keeps it at a population size of 800 individuals. So the good news here, I think, is that there's actually this doesn't have to take away resources from conservation of species in the wild. And nor should it, because there's lots of people out there who are really happy if they can say, you know, I'm maintaining a species that doesn't exist in the wild anymore. And then you might ask why. And I'm all for it, because, I mean, essentially this might provide some chance to address some of these outstanding questions that each of these species poses. So on that note, I want to thank you all for coming. I want to thank my fantastic postdoctoral advisors here at Berkeley, Erica Bree Rosenblum and Craig Miller. Thank you guys for coming. And also the Miller Institute for Basic Research in the Sciences, which is paying for my postdoc. Many different funding organizations. All of my fantastic undergrads at Davis who contribute to this work. So Stephanie Romero did over 5,000 scale growth ring measurements, as well as the female mate choice measurements, and here's the kiddie pools we used. And then my fantastic undergrads here at UC Berkeley, who are helping with this QTL mapping project. So,
Are the mollusks, where mollusk eating fish live, responding to the selection of being predated upon?
Yeah, I haven't gone in that sort of ecosystem direction, but there's lots you could do there, because there's lots of replication, there's lakes where there's no mollusk, of course. It would be quite fun to go in that sort of go-abo framework.
So, have you had a chance to, given you're dealing with so many fish, maybe not, but have you had a chance to determine whether or not these hybrids you've created and the ecological or the morphological space they're filling is correlated still with the behaviors? Like, would are the things that are closest to the scale eaters still actually trying to be scale eaters?
Yeah, I love that question, and I mean, I think it's a great idea because, you know, we really don't know if this. I mean, I think it definitely takes aggressive behavior, right? And we really don't know if that's linked to trophic morphology at all. And I think it would be fantastic. I've actually tried ways of quantifying aggression in captivity. It's hard, but I love to do mapping not just of the morphology, but also of the aggressive behavior as a start and try to ask. It would be hard to do that in the actual field experiment, but I think in a laboratory environment, I could map aggressive behavior, see where this is physically in the genome, and sort of make an argument from there.
A related question, particularly with respect to that behavior, scale eating, it's likely to be frequency dependent, so that the height of the fitness peak is gonna probably go down as the frequency of scale eaters goes up.
Definitely.
So have you?
So, great question. Yeah. And you point out something that I just avoided talking about throughout. I sort of talk about these as if they're static landscapes, but of course they're really frequency dependent, right? So you can think about the surface of a trampoline as you get more competitors, you're sort of depressing that fitness surface. So I didn't mention it, but that field experiment I set up this year, instead of manipulating density like the first time, I manipulated frequency this time. So I really hope to get at what parts of this fitness landscape are frequency dependent. But I'm actually really a big fan of, I mean, one take on this is Ben Holler's paper that came out a couple years ago. I don't know if you've seen it. But it's sort of the idea that maybe within a population, frequency dependence is really important. We sort of called it squashed stabilizing selection. But at this scale, I mean, I'm looking at morphologies that span almost as much phenotypic divergence as across all of Cyprinidon. At that scale, I really wonder if there are more static features of the fitness landscape. And I mean, my prediction is that as you move out to sort of larger and larger macroevolutionary scales, you find more and more sort of static, almost permanent features of fitness landscapes. Of course, it's hard to measure those, but it's a question I'm
still the deep valley.
Yeah, that maybe, you know, maybe when I manipulate frequencies, those peaks are definitely going to be squashed or within population, because essentially everything we know about selection in the wild is from one population measured in the wild. There's almost no studies of three species. So, yeah, I think Katie Ferris could do this as well with her work. But plant people, for some reason, they don't measure individual traits. They don't do individual fitness landscapes. But there's actually lots of plant examples.
We do traits, but we do a different analysis.
Yeah.
We don't make sense.
And I think David Resnick has data that you could get at with this too, but again, he sort of does it at the population level rather than an individual fitness landscape.
Would it be possible to do sympatric speciation in a lab situation where you create two different kinds of...
Yeah, that would be the best experiment of all time. I could just retire after that. I'd love to do that.
Well, you've got the kind of beast that it might work with, you know. I mean, some of us work with large mammals. And
it is unfortunate. You should all switch to pupfish. Yeah, I mean, like, theoretically, you could. I think a limitation of this system that I really love in bird systems is you can track multiple generations in the wild, almost. You can sort of track individual, you know, how many offspring do they produce. So in these fitness enclosures, the fish are laying eggs, but I can never find those eggs. So there's no way for me to do a multi-generation experiment in the field in pupfish. I could potentially try to create an enclosure, a small one, and do a multi-generation experiment that way. And actually, the first time I went to the island, I was looking for that setup. I was looking for a lake where I could collect every single fish, tag it, genotype it, right, put it back in. And there aren't lakes like that. So the smallest lake I found, I mean, it's only, gosh, maybe twice the size of this room, but you're talking 50,000 pupfish in that size. These things are really, really dense out there. But yeah, great idea.
So you sort of left us hanging with this question of why there aren't more sympatric species in the pupfish. And I mean, you said they're not escaping from the localized fitness peak in all of these different places.
Right.
I'm not even sure what the question is, but you sort of set the question back one step. And I guess one question is, if you look in these other lakes, how much variation do you see, phenotypic variation, for the kinds of traits that would be, you know, give rise to molluscan eating? Do you think that's in mutation selection balance? Does it exist at some lower level? Do you occasionally see sports that look very much like the molluscan eaters?
Yeah, so that's a great question. And I mean, I had that one plot of the principal component space, but that didn't really address you know, these rare. So I never saw these rare extremes that might look like a scale eater. There's just nothing out there except for one lake on Nassau, of all places. It's this dirty, dirty lake where I'm constantly sort of showing up and collecting fish in people's backyard, and they're like, what? But it's an interesting lake because there are some extremes. It's more like a unimodal distribution, first of all. So it's like these Cameroon cichlids. There aren't these discrete phenotypic clusters at all. But you do get some individuals that have large jaws. I'm not sure if they're eating scales. They're so rare that I only have about five so far. I have sequenced them, because I'm almost going to put this at the end here, but I've sequenced a few of them. They don't share any more ancestry with the scale eaters on San Salvador than any of these generalists or any of these other populations. I really thought they would, because I thought, okay, great, like this is standing genetic variation on Nassau. Somehow some of those alleles get to San Salvador, and the conditions are right on San Salvador, but they weren't on Nassau. And I completely agree, I left everyone hanging with what causes it, because I really thought it was going to be the genetic diversity, and then it wasn't. So now I think it might be this sort of weird, sort of serendipitous combination of alleles just happens to show up since in San Salvador. But
have you estimated the number of genes contributing to the difference between, say, scale eating and the generalist from the variants in F1s and F2s?
So I have a terrible estimate that a reviewer made me do. That is actually
me.
So. I mean, that's good. And I mean, I say terrible because it's only 15,000 SNPs, so it was just a Bayes scan, sort of FSD outlier scan. When I think it was basically 9 of those SNPs. So there's no fixed SNPs in that 14,000 scan.
Yeah.
9 of the SNPs were significant in a sort of Bayes scan analysis, up to an FST about 0.45. And interestingly, sort of the contrast was to the molluscivore, there were only about 6. So it was sort of, yeah, there's maybe more genetic changes you need to become an effective scale eater.
But just from the phenotypic variants in the F1s compared to the parents and the F2s compared to the F1s, you can get an estimate, right?
That I do have.
Yeah.
So this is just upper jaw length. But here's parental molluscivore, parental scale eater. Here's the distribution of F2 hybrids from this laboratory genetic mapping cross. So definitely polygenic, but hopefully not too much that it's mappable. I think the scale eaters might be diverged enough. There might be quite a few regions. I mean, that estimate of 9 from the genome size is about 1 gigabase.
And just the fact that you don't get any phenotypes anywhere near your parental phenotype for your scale eater that in your F2 that suggests the narrowness of your F2 distribution really suggests it's pretty polygenic.
Yeah, unfortunately.
Well, and it could be because it's different things like behavior and, oh wait, well this is just morphology, so never mind.
But you can actually estimate the number of genes from these distributions,
you can
right?
Hasselwright estimate.
Yeah, and I haven't measured the F1 variants yet.
Are there any obvious environmental or like food availability types of differences between the two times at which you collected them that could explain the difference in survival rates? And does that make a difference for the kind of fitness landscape that you're going to get out of your latest experiment?
Yeah, so yeah, that's a great question. So why did my second fitness experiment fail? So yeah, you're gonna make me cry, right? To do all that work. So it's like a month of just tagging fish. But so the second one I set up, I started it in May and I harvested it in September. So it was just the summer months. So I think it's this idea that the ecological bottleneck hypothesis, where winter is food scarcity, and that's when your trophic morphologies might really matter, and then you get an abundance of resources in the summer. Everything is surviving. Because the area of those field enclosures was 3 times larger, and I had about 100 survive the first time. So I was hoping for 300 to 400, about half, would have been perfect, I thought. And then fish just kept coming out of that thing. I just couldn't believe it. Just more and more fish, like all day long. So it takes a day to harvest one enclosure, right? And it's just one after, it was nuts. And it is going to be tricky to analyze that, right? Because, I mean, the thing I learned is that I should really be doing a 9-month experiment. And with generation times of about 9 months to a year, I think that's good overall. I'm not too worried about like picking out particular windows, like what does the fitness landscape look like in the summer versus the winter. I really just want to know overall.
Yeah, a couple questions about the Crater Lake system.
Oh, cool.
Do you have any idea what might be sort of driving the phenotypic variation that you're seeing in the species? I think it's really interesting that they're genetically not that different from each other.
Yeah.
And also, are these craters like volcanic craters? And I'm just trying to imagine like how colonization happens and gene flow and, you know, from other populations takes place in a system like that?
Yeah, so two of the three are volcanic craters, and one is essentially a volcanic crater. So they have just outflows, springs, that are sort of cascade waterfalls. So the idea is the cichlids aren't going to be able to jump up those waterfalls. You do get some smaller killifish things that are living in the stream, the colonizing. But the idea is essentially birds. Like a bird picks up a cichlid from a river 10 miles away, flies it over, and drops it into the crater. So one of the craters is 2 million years old. The other two are maybe 10 to 100,000 years old. And your first question, so what's causing the phenotypic divergence? Actually, I didn't show this part, but I measured assortative mating in one of the craters. So just by going out there and capturing mated pairs, so both parents guard the offspring, so you can actually capture them in situ, and then measure male and female phenotypes, and look at the strength of correlation as sort of a measure of how strongly they're assortatively mating. That was really, really strong. So here's, and along two different independent axes, so this is just canonical correlation analysis, but so here's the strength of, just sort of indicates, this linear regression just indicates how strong assortative mating is. And the other thing, I didn't show you this plot, but if you look at the distribution of the breeding coloration, it's quite a bit more bimodal, especially in this species complex. So at this point, my guess is that sexual selection is actually starting the divergence process, maybe carrying along some trophic morphology as well. These look to be somewhat linked. But the sexual symmetric speciation by sexual selection is supposed to be even more difficult of a process. So I really, that's my best guess. Who knows?
Great. Well, thank you very much for
it.
Oh,
thank you. Thanks. Thanks for your question, too.
Sure. I had another question for you, actually. Do you think that it's possible that somebody who wouldn't want to do it was illegally collected that fish from